and welcome to The Art of Being Human. We've been talking about grief, the symptoms of grief, what you go through when you are grief-stricken, and what happens to you, the whole process of the stages that you go through. One thing we haven't gone through that I want to go through today is the tasks of grief. What could you learn from the grief process? What happens to you for you to be able to adjust to grief or adjust to your life after the grief process is over? So these things are called the tasks of grief. What tasks do you accomplish in the grief process? This is fairly intense, and it happens, a lot of the symptoms happen concurrently with each other, but I want to go through that today. So let's just take a look at this chart, and I'm going to go through it. There are actually 4 to 5 tasks, things that you learn as you're going through the grief process. The symptoms we're familiar with, but we want to put them in context as to what happens and when it happens so you can understand how you can learn from it, grow from it, and readjust to a life without your loved one. And remember, this would occur not just with death, although that's the most preeminent one, but you have other kinds of losses too that cause grief, and you actually have the same kind of process, the same kind of task. But for now, we are actually focusing on the death process and losing somebody. So if we take a look at these tasks, the symptoms, task one is to be able to accept the loss, and that's difficult for some people. We know that the first stage is denial. This didn't happen, it couldn't happen, he's really not gone, we just think he's gone, and this kind of thing that you go through in your mind. But as you do that, the symptoms, you have shock, you have numbness, you have denial, and you have a gradual acceptance. This is what happens. Now, what I've done is I've split this chart into 2 sections. What goes through a person's mind, what they suffer from as they're going through the grief process, and what their needs are. If you are in the trying to help somebody out that's going through the grief process, what can you do for them? If they are trying to help themselves, they need to recognize what their needs are as they're going through the process. So the symptoms, once again, for the task one is in accepting the loss, shock, numbness, denial, and gradual acceptance. Acceptance doesn't come all at once. It is a gradual process. You don't have a loss one day and then suddenly the next day you say, okay, I accept it. This is all right. I can handle it. This is a very gradual growth process that you go through. The needs of a person who's going through that stage, they just need to have people present with them. I've mentioned before, when I lost my brother, I was terribly grief-stricken, and when I was at a house with a group of people, one of my friends was a female minister, was there, and she was just excellent. She stood beside me without saying anything. And if I walked across the room, she walked across the room with me and just stood beside me. She did not say a word. She just stood beside me. And her presence was a tremendous comfort to me because I knew somebody was there for me and she didn't have to say a thing. Sometimes all words are too much. Sometimes there has to be silence. But they need to have, a person going through this needs to have the sense of presence of somebody being there. A sense of caring, practical help. A lot of times people have difficulty doing just practical things. That's why if you say, call me if you need me, doesn't work. It's just not a good thing to say. But if you say, can I take the children for an afternoon? Can I cook a meal for you? Can I pick up your groceries for you? And give them specific things that they would have to do by themselves if you weren't there. That's much, much more help than saying, call me if you need me. Because truthfully, call me if you need me doesn't mean much. And most people won't call. Because the problem is people don't know what to say. How do you say the right thing? Sometimes you just don't know what to say. And so call me if you need me or I'm there for you. You know, it's a help, but it's just not enough help. It doesn't mean that much. So you have to do it a little differently. But you have to have that sense of presence, of caring, practical help, and spiritual comfort. You need to have all of those things. And if you have people that can, if you're going through the grief yourself, if you can have people help you with this and provide that for you, you will get through the grief a lot quicker. And if you are a person that's trying to help somebody else through the grief process, that can be a tremendous process. It can be a tremendous help just being there, just caring for them. Let them know that you care for them. The second task is to experience the pain. This gets to be a little difficult because nobody wants to do it. Grief is a terrible thing to go through. It's a horrible thing to go through. You can't control your emotions. You feel that it's just the worst thing that could ever happen to you. You don't understand why it's happened to you. You can't think rationally. You have to remember that there's nothing that's rational about the grief process. The things that you feel, the symptoms that you have, the things that you think, it's not rational. A lot of the things that happen to you are not rational. A lot of the feelings that you have are not rational. And then you feel guilty because you're not thinking right. Never feel guilty about whatever you think in the grief process, because it's going to be natural for the grief process. And if you try to make it rational and you try to make sense of it, you cannot do it at that time. Don't even try. Okay, so what do you have to experience in the pain of going through a death or loss? A lot of times there's guilt. Why couldn't I have been there for them? Why couldn't I have stopped the death? Why couldn't I have done more? Or if you had a conflict with a person who passed on, why couldn't we have resolved this? There's all kinds of feelings that go around. Resentment. Resentment at the person who died. You know, you left me. Why did you leave me? Why did you abandon me? And that is not rational, because the person, generally speaking, unless it's a suicide, did not choose to die, but their systems just broke down and they did die. But you can be angry. Anger at a person who died is not uncommon in a grief reaction, so you don't even have to feel guilty about that. Remorse that you didn't have a better relationship with them, or remorse that you did things that were hurtful to them. Yearning. Now, this yearning, there is a word called episodic pangs. An episodic pang is when you deeply want to have somebody back, or deeply want to have a pet back or a job back, and you just pine after it and you yearn after it. And that's a very painful process, because you get to relive what things were. And if it's not to your liking now because you're without a person that you cared for, that yearning comes in so strongly, it's very hard to handle. Apathy, which is kind of the opposite. You know, I don't care. Oh, you know, this is what it is. That's also a symptom of the grief process, because usually you're not apathetic at all. But in grief, anything goes. It's just natural. Despair. Anger. What are you angry at? I couldn't stop the death. I'm angry at the person who died. I'm angry at the illness that they had. I'm just plain angry. And sometimes it's very hard to pinpoint what the anger is, but it's a part of the process. Anxiety, a feeling of emptiness, like you're alone, there's nothing there. Depression, loneliness, panic. Disorientation, when things just don't make sense. The loss of clear identity. A lot of people, I want to go into that for a minute. A lot of people identify themselves as being connected to somebody else. And the reason this is true is that we all connect ourselves with something. We attach ourselves. This is normal for the human being to attach yourself. You attach yourself to a spouse, to a child, to friends, to an idea, to an organization. You know, you can attach yourself in many different ways to many different things. And the loss of your clear identity comes when you no longer are attached. For many women, if you ask them who they are, oh, I'm John's wife. I'm Sarah's daughter. You know, they identify themselves in terms of what their connectedness is to somebody else. And they don't have a good, clear identity of who they are because they're connecting themselves and they view their identity as being with somebody else. Well, when that gets cut, and the identity is no longer there because one person has passed on, then it's confusing to the person. Who am I anyway? Now, I think that every child should learn to have an identity that's within themselves. Yes, you need to be connected. It's not normal not to be connected. And a lot of mental illnesses occur when people can't connect with others and can't connect with ideas or with a philosophy or with other people. We do attach ourselves. And some of the mental illnesses that we have are called attachment disorders because people don't attach. And one of them is autism. But there are other illnesses too that happen when you don't attach yourself. But if your identity is only in an attachment and you don't have a clear identity of who you are outside of the attachment, then I think you're missing something because things change. You know, you may get a divorce or somebody may move away. You're no longer attached and then your identity is shaken because you don't know who you are anymore because the thing that you're attached to is no longer there. Not necessarily just in death. Maybe the person has moved on, or maybe you've split up, or is something like that has happened where there's been a separation. Whenever you have a separation, then you have loss, and then you have grief. But if you are connected to who you lost, or even an organization, the organization goes down and you're no longer connected with the organization, then you have to reformulate what your identity really is. You need to have a strong self-identity and you need to have attachments. You need to have both. But people who go through loss, a lot of them don't have both. They were strictly attached to a person. And then when that person is no longer there, for whatever reason, whether it be death or loss or they moved or you split up, whatever it is, then you're going to have to re-identify yourself. And that's a painful process. I think the people who go through grief the best and the healthiest are people who have a firm self-identity. It doesn't mean they have any less attachments, but they are who they are, and they don't have to depend upon their attachments to identify themselves because they also have an identity that's within themselves. So that's a mental health issue, but there would be a loss of clear identity and physical symptoms. I've listed them down, and we went over that the last segment. The needs that they have, caring, listening, if they want to talk, by all means talk, encouragement and catharsis. Catharsis has a meaning. Catharsis is when you let something go out of your system, when you talk about it, when you cry, when you bang your fist on the table, just getting your emotions out so that you're not holding them in. That's considered to be catharsis. Crying is catharsis. Therapy is catharsis. Talking to a friend about a problem is catharsis. You are not holding something in. You are letting it out. And I can't tell you how important that is. For mental health, it's extremely important. Now, task three, adjusting to the environment. This is what you learn. You learn how to make decisions on your own, especially if you're married and you never made a decision on your own. You learn how to make decisions on your own. That is not necessarily an easy thing to do. If you're not used to making decisions and you rely constantly on the input of your spouse or your boyfriend or your girlfriend, that's normal to do that. But now you see there's a transition. That boyfriend or girlfriend or wife or husband is no longer there. And so therefore you now have the sole responsibility of making decisions. That's why it's said that you should not make major decisions for about a year to get rid of the house, to move somewhere else, to get a different job, to move out of the local area. And some of those decisions that you make may not be the right ones if you do them too soon, because you can't think clearly enough. If you can wait and not make decisions, major decisions, for a year, you're probably better off. But of course, there are some cases where it has to be made. You have to make decisions and you can't wait. And you hope that you can just make the right ones. But for some people, it's going to be a kind of a guess. Coping skills, how to get along without your loved ones, how to live normal life, you know. He doesn't run to the grocery store for you anymore. He always, like, I know people whose husbands do all the grocery shopping. They don't go to a grocery store. Their husbands do it. Then the husband passes on, and they have to do all those things that their husbands did. I know of women who have never handled a checkbook in their lives. They have never done it because their husbands always did it. You know, the husbands took care of the finances. They took care of everything else. It's not that they had a bad relationship, but the division of who does what was so pronounced and so clear. Nobody did anybody else's job. Now you have to take over the job of not only yourself, but whoever is lost. And for a family, say the husband is lost, the husband has passed away, now the wife has to do the shopping. She has to handle the checkbook. She has to pay the bills. She has to know what's due and when it's due. And a lot of women just don't do that. They just leave that up to their husbands. Now, that's not a bad thing necessarily, but it's an inconvenient thing should something happen. I think every wife and husband should get together, and not only do they divide their responsibilities, but each one knows what the other is doing, why they're doing it, when they are doing it, what the bills are, when they're due. So even if they're not doing it all, they have an understanding of what the other person is doing. And so if should anything happen, they can take over the extra responsibilities and it won't be so difficult for them. Know what's going on in your family life. Okay. Coping skills, saying goodbye. This is a problem. You have to say goodbye to the person. There has to be closure. The one thing that a funeral is supposed to do, and sometimes I get upset with the cost of funerals and what goes on in funerals, but the one thing that they do, and they do well, is that they give closure. You know, if you can say goodbye to a person, it's hard to do it. You don't want to do it. But if you can say goodbye to them and get that closure, then you can move on in your life. It's extremely difficult to do. It's extremely agonizing. It's also terribly important that you do it. You know, when I lost somebody, and I mentioned it before in another show, probably this one, and the person that I was close to died, in Boston, I went to Boston. I had some friends and I said, I need to go, I need to have closure. I need to go to Boston. So I went to Boston and they took me, my friends took me to the place where he died. And I was able, in a sense, to say goodbye at that point. And when that happened and I had that closure, then I was able to go on with my life. The odd thing is that I've never been to Boston since, and I love the city. I really love the city. But once I said goodbye and it was over, I never returned to Boston again. I think I probably should go back just to kind of reinvest myself in it again. So you say goodbye. How do you know when you're healing? When you can reinvest your energy from the loved one to something else. New people, old friends, new situation, new job, whatever it is. You take the energy that you have invested in the loved one, that you concentrated only on the loved one, and in the funeral process, you concentrated only on the funeral. And as you're healing from that, you take the energy that was invested only in the person that you cared about and start to reinvest it elsewhere. It can be another person, it can be something else, it can be another job, it can be anything, but you reinvest your energy in something else or somebody else or a new situation. So your mind is not constantly thinking of the person who died. Your mind is thinking about new things coming up. When you make that transition, when you start to make that transition, then you know that the healing has begun. Because while you are dominated, constantly dominated by the person that you love, you're not healing, you're invested still. And that's part of the raw emotion that goes on in a death, and that has to happen, so I get that. But at some point, you need to start reinvesting energy elsewhere. It will happen naturally. As the grief starts to abate, you will start investing your energy elsewhere. And that's a good sign of the healing process. Now, what a person needs is they may need crisis care. Crisis care is what you do if an emergency comes up or something unusual happens and you may need to step in and help out in some kind of way. You may need to intervene in some kind of way. That's crisis care. A person may need to have counseling help when that's going on, and reality testing. Reality testing is when you test things out to see if they're good or they're not. For example, supposing I lost somebody and I decided, should I go and move? Well, is it a good thing for me to move? Is it not a good thing for me to move? I may not know. I test the waters maybe by moving and seeing what it's like. I test the waters by doing other things. In my case, with the death of my friend in Boston, if I were to reality test, I might have decided, let me move to Boston and see how I like the city to live in, not just to visit. Now, that might not be such a good move because it would be traumatic. But reality testing, you just test the waters and you do things to see if it fits or if it doesn't fit. A lot of people, of course, do not have the luxury of reality testing. They have to continue just to live and to do the things they have to do. But if you reality test, you try something new, you try something different, you see if it's a good fit for you, you try a new job. It doesn't have to be as drastic as moving. It can be simple things. You try meeting new people, you try going to new places. Do you like it? Do you not like it? And so you work it through, and then you kind of, in a sense, change your identity with it so you know more about who you are and what you like, because your identity now has to be forged around yourself, not around the person that you lost. So your identity will change some, and so you have to test out and see what fits and what doesn't fit. And we're about out of time, so I'm going to just close it here. We only have a couple minutes left. And I'm going to finish with this in the next segment and talk about also how you can help a person, what practical things you can do to help a person who is in grief. So we will continue with this and hopefully conclude it next time. So please join me next week.